Welcome to Korea and the World, a podcast on political, economic, and social issues from the perspective of the Korean Peninsula.
Around 2 million ethnic Koreans live in the United States. This makes them the second largest Korean diaspora after the one in China. Los Angeles and New York even have the largest Korean populations outside of cities on the Korean Peninsula. Koreans in America have been referred to as a model minority due to their educational and economic achievements. Yet, they also face racial discrimination and isolation. To learn more about how Koreans have navigated American issues of race and inequality, we met with Professor Nadia Kim. She told us about the history of Korean migration to the United States and the role of America's military presence in Asia, the socialization process of immigrants that already starts on the Korean Peninsula, and the hardships Korean immigrants face once they arrive in the US. Nadia Kim is Associate Professor of Sociology at Loyola Marymount University. She obtained her bachelor at the University of California, Santa Barbara, and received a PhD from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor. She was also a postdoctoral fellow at the Center for Comparative Immigration Studies at the University of California, San Diego. Her most recent book, and the subject of this interview, is Imperial Citizens, Koreans and Race from Seoul to LA. Professor Nadia Yongna Kim, welcome to Korea and the World.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here.
What sparked your interest in those who migrate from Korea to the United States?
It could be considered partly me-search, which scholars sometimes consider the biographical interest that motivates scholars. So I am the child of Korean immigrants to the United States and Canada. And I always wanted to understand my parents' journey, my grandparents, etc., and realized that I knew very little. In part because your parents can only tell you so much, but also because in the United States, so much of the discourse on race has to do with the white over black hierarchy. So it was a personal interest as well as an interest sparked by the 1992 Los Angeles riots. I prefer to call the 1992 LA unrest or rebellion, to emphasize the political nature of it. But that in and of itself was a watershed moment for me and many Korean Americans, because it was the first time that we really saw our group on television, throughout the mass media, and also, secondly, the first time we saw our group discussed in racial terms, very explicit racial terms. So all of a sudden, conflict that had originally erupted between white American LAPD officers and a black American motorist named Rodney King became a riot in which mostly ostensibly black Americans were looting and setting fire to Koreatown and Korean businesses, and therefore a conflict between so-called blacks and Koreans. And I watched this in horror, seeing the sky turn black from all the arson, and really believe that what was going on was much more complicated than what sensationalistic media soundbites could tell the American people. But it also really bothered me that my own education up to that point could not tell me what that more complicated picture was. Viscerally, instinctually, I believed that this was not just about Korean immigrants and Black American natives hating each other, but that this was a more complicated story about U.S. power abroad and racial, social systems in the United States, immigration and anti-immigrant sentiment at play. But because my school textbooks and even later my university research and articles could not answer those questions for me, I decided to pursue the interest myself.
Could you give us a brief introduction of Korean migration to the United States? Why do Koreans migrate? How many did? And where in the United States do they tend to move?
That's a great question. If I start at the earliest point, then you have American missionaries recruiting labor from Korea to Hawaiian plantations. And this is in the early 1900s. So because Korea was a much poorer country at the time, and U.S. missionary and other influences, political influences, were quite strong, that you see a Korean stream going to the United States at this point. Those who also, you know, considered the United States obviously a Christian nation, an incredibly wealthy and powerful nation, were drawn to the country for those reasons as well. And then you have, you know, these tricklings of Koreans coming in. For example, in the 1950s, the generation my father was a part of as an international student, going, you know, to the Midwest, for example, or going to universities that will accept them. And you have, of course, the Korean War brides that are coming through post-Korean War as the wives of servicemen. And actually, much of the Korean migration to the United States can be attributed to those women who came as the wives of servicemen. And many Korean families can trace the original U.S. migrant to these women. Sometimes these women were actually they were working in the sex work industry in Korea and met American soldiers and then also came to the U.S. So it's a very women-centered kin migration stream. Then, of course, you have the mass migration around 1970 after the landmark 1965 U.S. Immigration Act is passed, which essentially eliminated the racial and national quotas that the United States had set up in 1924 to stem migration from not just Asia and Latin America. Up to that point, it was basically already stopped. But to actually slow the influx of Southern and Eastern Europeans to the United States. So it was a way of actually racially engineering the United States to be a more Northwestern European country. And so for the period leading up to 1924, there were actually all of these exclusion acts against Asians specifically. Many people are probably aware of the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act, the Gentlemen's Agreement with Japan. All of these acts were issued to bar Asians from coming into the United States. And Asians actually are the only group in U.S. history to be barred on the basis of race from the United States. So by 1924, they were basically barred. So in 1965, because of the U.S. starting to recognize, the John F. Kennedy administration starting to recognize that there was this major contradiction between the U.S. being the most powerful and advanced democracy in the world that accepted all people to its shores, as the Statue of Liberty says, and then on the other hand, having racist exclusion acts, and also, as many of us are familiar with, the civil rights movement erupting and letting the world know that actually major injustices were being committed against Black Americans on the basis of race. So at that point, acknowledging that contradiction, the United States government changed the law and eliminated those racial quotas, thinking that the only major group that would come into the United States would be Southern Eastern European immigrants. But of course, what they ended up doing was opening the floodgates to Asia and Latin America. And those are the people who mostly came. So that is, you know, when in 1970, most Korean immigrants started coming. And that has been the major immigration stream since. I don't have specific numbers, because I'm not a demographer, but essentially, many of them go to Los Angeles, right, California. Many of them go to New York. Many of them go to Chicago. So lots of cities, because immigrants tend to go to cities. And they tend to also go to places where their family or their friends or their contacts have gone before them, especially Korean towns, or at least towns or areas where there are a lot of Koreans, as well as Korean commerce, as well as support organizations for Koreans to help get adjusted to their country, the United States. The other places where Koreans have been increasingly going are southern cities. So places like Atlanta, for example, people going to Virginia. So that has also been a trend in the migration streams. Los Angeles is the site of the largest Korean population in the United States. And you can call it the next largest Korean city outside of anything in South and North Korea. So in terms of the importance of Los Angeles to Korean America, it can't be understated.
Let's start by looking at Korean migrants to America before they even leave, while they are still in Korea. A core argument of your book is that the socialization process of Korean migrants did not start when they arrived on U.S. ground, but rather before they even left South Korea. How is that possible?
Yes, that's the core argument of my book, that we often consider ourselves bound and insulated by our countries or by our cultures. But if you look at world history, especially its colonial, imperial, and neocolonial and neo-imperial legacy, you recognize that countries and cultures have always influenced one another. So one of the main audiences I'm responding to is the sociologists of immigration in the United States, who, when often talking about race, would talk about it as if there was no American understanding or no, you know, exchange with the United States prior to living in the country. And I was also responding to people who are studying transnationalism and globalization, but who were really not paying attention enough to the way in which not only racial hierarchies, racial institutions, but racial ideologies get formed, right, and reshaped as people move. So I'm responding to various literatures. Another literature and audience I'm responding to is the sociologists of race and ethnicity in the United States, who tend to talk about white over black issues, but not necessarily conceptualize racialized systems or racial hierarchies with regard to Asian Americans and Latinos and Native Americans, or indigenous groups, I should say. So I'm responding to all of these literatures and really trying to come up with a paradigm specific to this case, which is, how did Koreans come to understand race in the United States? So I answer that by saying, if you use the neo-imperialist colonial paradigm, you recognize that this understanding of race, right, peoplehood, nation, is something that was influenced, for example, by the Japanese, as well as the United States, because of the external powers coming to the Korean Peninsula. So what I argue is that American intervention, Japanese intervention, shaped the way that Koreans came to understand not just those groups, but themselves. And it's that understanding that often allows them to construct in their minds, they think America is, or who the American people are, where Korean or Asian people would even fit in an American landscape. And so I argue that through both top-down transnationalism, so that is transnationalism that came about through the U.S., going to Korea, basically in the 1940s, at the end of Japanese colonization, at the end of World War II, and through thereafter, American corporate financial influence, American popular cultural influence, that racial messaging was transmitted. And Koreans, using their own cultural lexicon and cultural logic, such as ethno-nationalism, the idea of pure bloodlines and the nation sharing a bloodline, like an extended family, the notions that social order and hierarchy are normal and natural, such as through Confucianism, that using those cultural logics, they're interpreting the American racial ideologies, the American racialized hierarchies that the U.S. imported into Korea. So then that is what they're taking to the United States. It's not that they're blank slates and that they then go to the United States and then learn everything. You know, that would completely discount the role of not just history, but it discounts the role of cultural globalization.
In your book, you write that, and I quote, "Without a grasp of South Koreans' own cultural system, it is impossible to see through their eyes the way they interpret American racialization and take part in imperialist racial formation." What would you say is the minimum prerequisite to understand the Korean cultural system in this context?
To answer that, I think it's important to first define what American racialization is and imperialist racial formation. The second term is something that I coined myself. So in terms of what American racialization is, I'm really borrowing from the acclaimed sociologists of race, Michael Omi and Howard Winant. Essentially, what racialization is characterizing a previously unclassified group or social practice or system as racial in some way, shape, or form. So giving racial meaning to something that previously did not have racial meaning. So racialization is often the name for that process of giving racial meaning to something, whether it's a group or a practice or a society, right? So giving that racial meaning when it did not exist before. So just to give an example, American racialization would be when the United States comes in and there are a lot of white American people, right? And there are also Black American people. So in that sense, American racialization as a process is going on because in Korea, there was an understanding of the U.S. being a white country, right, having white people, but there wasn't that strong of an understanding of Black Americans, right? So here you have a racial meaning of America is a white country. I mean, that in and of itself is a meaning because one could actually argue that the Americas are the countries or the places where indigenous people call themselves at home, right? They call them their nation within the Americas. So even that in itself is a meaning. But secondly, the meaning could be extended to, oh, America racially is about having white people as a majority over Black people or dark-skinned people as a minority. So you're bringing in those racialized meanings into a country that hadn't really thought along those lines before or hadn't at least thought about it in extensive ways. So that's a version of American racialization, right? If I use an example of the United States, it could be when the U.S. government would all of a sudden classify a group that had previously maybe been thought of as one race, maybe white, for example, and then putting them in another race, such as Black or whatever, and then giving meanings like the white race is superior, the Black race is inferior, right? So that's an example of the United States. As far as imperialist racial formation, this whole idea of racialization, this process, is part of this broader racial paradigm that Omi and Winant name as racial formation. Okay, so racialization is a process within this broader system of racial formation. And I add imperialist racial formation to say that Omi and Winant were mostly focusing on the United States and within the bounds of the United States. So nation was not central to this system that they called racial formation, right? So I wanted to add, well, racial formation also involves the ways in which nations are given racial meaning, right? And the way in which nations actually can be understood as racially ranked and racially categorized. So for example, we take Europe, we take North America, right? These are countries that have diverse populations, but they are racialized as white areas, right? So that's an example of how we would understand nations as also part of this racial formation system. Another way we can look at it is, for example, how different countries might racialize themselves along different lines. So for example, in Korea, there's often a conflation of race and nation, the idea that our nation is one race. And of course, up until recently, that was a given. Now we're talking about multiculturalism, and that's another issue we can talk about later. But the idea is that we racialize our nation as one race, one blood. In the United States, you know, they wouldn't necessarily racialize the nation that way because there's not just one people that's existed together for 5,000 years. I mean, it's a much different history. But the way that the U.S. might racialize itself is based on, you know, the majority, our founding fathers. The majority of the country is white. Our founding fathers were white, so white country. That's the way in which I want to bring in nation as part of this racial formation system. Now, with imperialist, of course, I'm being really specific in talking about the importance of imperialism, the history of imperialism, as well as neo-imperialism as it continues today, as also highly influential on this racial formation system. So in South Korea, I'd like to call it an imperialist racial formation because these different notions of race, right, entered through Japanese colonialism, through U.S. imperialism and neo-imperialism. So I want to really emphasize that part as well.
So on a day-to-day basis, how did the individual Korean get exposed to this American worldview?
Of course, as a good sociologist, I can't speak for every individual because individuals vary so much. But what I can say is that any imperialist or neo-imperialist power is going to be known by the everyday person. And whether the knowledge extends to, well, this is a country that has come in and intervened, helped liberate us from the Japanese after World War II, is a nation that has come in and helped fight on our side, on the South Korean side against the North. You know, those things are so powerful and fraught that every individual at that time knows that, at least to that extent. So from that, what do we gather? Well, we gather that the United States is a superpower, that the United States is a more powerful country than our country, its military, its economy, etc., that the United States is benevolent and humanitarian because they didn't have to come help our poorer third world country in this, you know, war effort, but they did. So if you put that together with the fact that America was understood as a white country, then you recognize that it is white America that has come in and helped liberate us from very painful and very extensive external power and influence and inequality, right? So that's the example of Japan, but also, you know, from attack. They helped us when North Korea attacked us, right? They saved us from communism. So, you know, all of that I think is really important to connect, but oftentimes the literatures aren't necessarily connecting race with this political and war history. So I think that's really, really central. On a day-to-day basis, there were some Koreans who actually interacted with American soldiers and saw American soldiers. So that interaction obviously is very powerful because not only do you have this general knowledge of white America's benevolence, humanitarian aid, military intervention, the role they played as saviors from North Korea and communism, but you also have this very direct person-to-person interaction that teaches Koreans not just that these people actually enact it every day when they, you know, give us food or when they pass out chocolate to children or when they help treat Korean injuries and Korean people's war-borne injuries, for example. But these are people who look like this, right? I mean, that they're, given that Korea was more of a homogenous nation at the time, there's this idea that, wow, you know, there's the big nose, blue-eyed, pale-skinned, you know, Westerner, right, that has come in. And then, of course, because of the Korean War, you have Koreans slowly becoming more aware of Black Americans, right? Wow, we see these people who have dark skin and features we would associate more with people from Africa. Their hair is tighter in terms of the curl pattern, you know, things like that. And so not only is that something that Koreans came to understand as these phenotypic distinctions, but also, as I said earlier, came to understand as the group over which white America dominated, right? These are a minority group. They are basically more subservient. They take on lower status roles when you look at U.S. military bases or U.S. military operations. You know, these are things that Koreans came to know because of the Korean militarization of the peninsula through imperialism, through neo-imperialism. So then what happens is that the individual interprets these American people and this American hierarchy through, as your earlier question asked, through Korean cultural logics, right, and Korean cultural understandings. So there was already an understanding that Africa, the continent of Africa, or dark-skinned regions of the globe were poorer or tended to be poorer and tended to be lower in terms of the global hierarchy, economic hierarchy, right? But because we're also talking about the way in which that global economic hierarchy is racialized, the idea that those are people from those racial regions of the world that are economically undeveloped or underdeveloped. So Korea's linking that understanding to then seeing Black Americans coming from the United States, even though the U.S. is a superpower and a rich country. And so, you know, there's some recognition that Black Americans come from a very privileged nation. But at the same time, within that nation, they are second-class citizens. So the day-to-day Korean is getting to know this. And one of the ways that we came to know that is, if you look at Korean literature at the time, you know, post-Japanese liberation, post-Korean War, you start not just seeing American characters that are white, but you start seeing American characters that are Black. So from a survey of Korean literature, you start realizing that this is becoming more and more part of the Korean understanding of who America is, who are the people that comprise America.
Was this racialization process easily accepted, or was it ever contested or resisted at all?
Yes, I think that's a great question. In the beginning, I think it was more about Koreans really just trying to learn and discover what this American country was and who the people were that comprised it. And according to sociologist John Lee, he talks about how Koreans tended to be more internally divided or internally differentiated because of region of the country, because of class, because of language and, you know, different regional dialects and things like that, right? That there are these major differences that differentiate Korea. But social psychology has always taught us that when you bring an outsider in, you know, a major external power, a major group, that Koreans themselves, just like any other group, start noticing differences more between us and them, us and the United States or us and Japan, for example, versus just within our own group, right? So I think that in the beginning, you know, there's this discovery period, as I mentioned, but also this kind of coalescing of what Koreanness is in opposition to the United States or Japan. And then what's really important to discuss is the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, Koreans often conflated race and nation. So the way that they categorize and see the world is often Japanese, Korean, Chinese, right? German, French, etc. But when you start noticing that these U.S. white Americans, Black Americans who come in are not differentiated that way. They're more lumped together. These different European ethnicities get lumped together as 미국 사람, they're white people. And then you see these Black Americans that are ethnically undifferentiated. So you don't know if those black people are from originally, you know, their ancestors are from the United States. For example, they're the descendants of slaves, or if they're immigrants from Ghana or Jamaica or what have you, right? So there is this kind of racialization process that Koreans are interpreting and receiving, whereby Americans really aren't talking about themselves in terms of their, you know, specific European national origins or those of their grandparents or great-grandparents, you know, or in terms of the origins of the blacks that are in Korea. So there is that kind of racialized understanding that Koreans start negotiating and dealing with. The other major thing that I think is really important to cite is that starting in about the 1980s, the student democratization movements were against the United States in many ways because of what they considered the imperialist dimensions of U.S. intervention in Korea. So major social movements really began erupting in Korea in the 1980s. And it became bigger because a lot of middle-class people and educated people started really sympathizing with and aligning themselves with the student movements. So, of course, the 1980 Gwangju massacre was a watershed moment at that time because the student demonstrators in Gwangju were murdered. And the press at the time were really talking about how it was the Korean military who killed the student protesters, right? But if you look at how much power the U.S. military had over the Korean military at that time, there had to be knowledge on the part of the U.S. military. There had to be approval by the U.S. military in order for the Korean military forces to even have gone in and massacred the Korean student demonstrators. So that was, you know, a major salvo for the Korean anti-U.S. movements at the time. So up until that point, it had been much more pro-U.S. Like I'd mentioned, you know, the U.S. saved us from Japan, from communism, North Korea, etc. But then starting in about the 1980s, there was a lot more anti-U.S. sentiment. And so with that anti-U.S. sentiment, there's also a racial component, right? Because the idea is you have the superior Euro-American race coming in, trying to take advantage of our country and use our peninsula for its own benefit. And they often do that through their own racism against us, right? Thinking us Koreans to be inferior or dismissible or disposable, right? And the U.S. military and the U.S. military government role in, for example, suppressing Korean protest or Korean opposition, starting with U.S. intervention in Korea. For example, the people who were, you know, really fighting for democratization early, many of those people were tortured or imprisoned or killed. And so, you know, there's a lot of that understanding that the U.S. is involved always in some way, shape, or form. So, you know, it was not always a smooth, just, you know, we received this as kind of this new cultural system that's coming in. It wasn't just that.
If white superiority was a given in this new system, and black inferiority was only relative to the white superiority, why did Koreans end up considering themselves superior to African Americans, not equals?
Yes, that's an excellent question as well. I think it's important to actually incorporate into the question the idea that different time periods involve different types of racial ideologies. Korea, during the time of Japanese colonization and soon after, you know, was basically this poor, war-torn third world country. So as far as thinking themselves better economically than nations in Africa, for example, I don't think that that was a central part of the calculus. But because color hierarchies, skin color hierarchies had long existed in Korea because of the agrarian hierarchy, the yangban over the peasants, and that yangban were paler and lighter skinned because they were privileged and economically higher, so they spent a lot of time indoors, whereas Korean peasants and farmers, they were darker skinned, right? They were outside working. So in terms of a color hierarchy, that did already exist. So Koreans already did see themselves as better than or higher than those with darker skin, right? And especially very dark skin, such as what you'd find in the African regions, for example. So there you see an example of how internal class and color hierarchies are able to kind of intersect with and align with American hierarchies, right? So in that sense, there is already this notion of being better than. Then what happens is Korea develops rapidly, starting around the 1960s, because ironically, Japanese colonialism allowed Korea to set up its own capitalist economy, often drawing on Japan's old economic institutions and infrastructure, that Korea develops rapidly. So at that point, you're seeing Korea understand itself along the lines of the white West is the richest, the Asians are middle and kind of, in a funny use, the phrase middle class, right? Like the middle class region of this global economic hierarchy. And then you have blackened nations, right? So maybe next would be Southeast Asia, maybe certain Latin American countries, and then Africa. And so this is actually not my original argument. This is also from sociologist John Lee, who studies Asia, Korea, and, you know, found this to be this kind of racialized understanding of the new global hierarchy, right? So there is this sense from before with the skin color hierarchy, and then with this sense of being above those nations that have dark-skinned black people, that you get this sense of that's why we're superior to, or we're in at least a position higher than black Americans in the United States, right? You trace their ancestors to those African nations, so their blood, right, is fundamentally reflective of those African nations, those poor, undeveloped African countries, politically undeveloped. And then you have the notion based on skin color, right? And that obviously is a legacy of colonialism across the globe. And, you know, then you have this understanding that black people in general in the United States are subordinate because they are lower class in the United States, right? Economically, they're not strong. And that's why white Americans are stronger and more powerful than blacks in the U.S. So understanding oneself as this kind of middle class Asian country within this kind of middle class Asian kind of broader umbrella category of the globe, then you have this understanding of being better than and above. But as a final point, I think it's really important to include that because Koreans are also concerned not just with class and color hierarchies, but also with political recognition, this notion of recognition, right? That because blacks are part of the United States and a central part of the United States, really seen as the second racial group behind whites in many ways because of the colonial white-black legacy and the white-black history of the United States, that they have way more recognition across the globe as a people than Koreans do. And that if you look in terms of the political figures or the cultural figures that people can name, and this is even before Obama, who are black, if you ask the globe, name a major Korean political figure or a major Korean cultural figure, much of the globe cannot answer that question. This is, you know, before Hallyu, but I would say even with Hallyu, I don't know if the globe as a whole would be as familiar with Rain, right, for example, who kind of became, or even Psy, as they would with Martin Luther King. So I think that while Koreans position themselves above black Americans based on this color class kind of national bloodline dimension, they're really not doing that in terms of how much political and cultural recognition Korea would get or Korean people would get compared to black people. So they're actually positioning themselves below. And one of the major arguments of my book is that it's partly because blacks are part of the United States and blacks are actually here in Korea as part of the American military and more, you know, frequently coming as politicians, that Korea doesn't position themselves above blacks or black Americans in terms of that axis of political recognition. namesake recognition that is also central to where nations or where people who come from those nations are positioned in social hierarchies.
Thus far, the discussion was focused on the process taking place in South Korea. Let's look at what happens in the United States. How did Korean immigrants adapt to life in the United States? Did their pre-departure socialization help them?
I think it helps, but I also think that, you know, when you live in a country, there's nothing else that replaces it. You have to actually live somewhere to really experience what it is, and that includes racially, ethnically, culturally. You know, one of the things that I think is important to emphasize is that I don't mean by Koreans having had this experience and encounter with the United States prior to coming that they knew everything about American racial dynamics and hierarchies. They absolutely did not. But I think what's important is to acknowledge that whiteness is also racial. One of the ways in which inequality happens is that we often mark the other, but we don't mark the reference group as racial, for example. So, you know, it's so important to know and understand and integrate the fact that because the U.S. had been in Korea since the 1940s, and Western influence had even come through in many ways during the Japanese colonial era, and Japanese colonials also defined America as a white country, right? America was defining itself as a white country. That is so important for Koreans already coming to understand their own otherness in relationship to the United States and their own kind of marginality and their invisibility with regard to the United States. And that's why when I was talking earlier about political recognition, that's so important because, you know, for a long time, you know, you'll hear a lot of this ethno-nationalist discourse in Korea about how no one knows where Korea is or no one really knows deeply about Korean culture or Korean history or Korean cultural figures or the language, right? And of course, that has changed in recent decades. But it's not as though Koreans would say, oh, the global language now that, you know, the West is trying to learn is Korean. It's Mandarin or it's Spanish or what have you. So it's important to recognize that they came with an understanding of this white country, but also this white over black country. So that's also central. When I'm talking about whiteness, I can't talk about whiteness without talking about the other racializations that allow whiteness to exist. So whiteness exists because blackness exists. Whiteness exists because Asianness exists, for example, right? Anyways, they had this understanding of this country as white over black. But there's also this understanding of, okay, well, if it's white over black, then where are Asians? Where are other people of the world? Because we know that there are other people besides whites and blacks, right? And we know that it's an iminara, right? It's a place where immigrants go. It's a nation fundamentally formed by way of immigration. So that's something that most people have some knowledge of or some consciousness of before coming. And then when they are in the United States, I think where the pre-socialization kind of interrelates with and aligns with the post-US arrival is the fact that, okay, there is no doubt that this is a white over black country, that the majority group is white, the national identity, the reference point is white, and secondarily black, and in subordinated fashion black. But one of the major ways in which Koreans, you know, come to, I guess, a new understanding of the United States in terms of its racial formation is that there are all these Mexican people, right? And there are all these Latino people, especially for the Koreans that go to California or go to the western region of the country. And that is something that they know very little of prior to coming because of the way in which the military is often defined in such white and black terms. Pop culture from the United States is often defined as white and black, right? And so in Korea, you know, there are increasingly more and more Latino soldiers and soldiers from other racial ethnic groups, but I think Koreans were just kind of more looking at dividing people based on light, you know, and white and dark and black. So they probably just fitted those people into one of those categories. And Latinos, obviously, are a diverse group. They're white and black, and they're indigenous. And so you can kind of fit them into one of those categories. But when they came to California in particular, Los Angeles, there was a surprise and a shock at how many Mexicans, or, you know, what they considered people who are Mexican, but obviously they come from other countries too in Central America, how many were here and how much Spanish was spoken, right? And that's partly because, as I told you earlier, Koreans go to cities. And so in cities, like in Los Angeles, there are lots of immigrants from Mexico and Central America who are, you know, right there in Koreatown, working in Koreatown, living in Koreatown, or the neighborhoods are all really close together. So in terms of the frequency of interaction and how many people Koreans are interacting with, it's quite a lot. So I think that's one of the ways in which they're not prepared, right? They don't understand that. But going back to the question of where Koreans are socially located or where Asians fit in the United States, as I said earlier, you know, there's this idea of marginality, invisibility, lack of recognition. And when they go to the United States, I think that gets really reinforced by the fact that they realize, oh my goodness, now we're just lumped in this umbrella category with anyone who looks like us. You know, there is this understanding from Korea that America doesn't always talk about itself in ethnic terms, right? Or differentiate among their population ethnically. By that, I mean by the original nation you could trace that person to. But I think there is quite a shock and surprise that Koreans are not well known, or that you can literally not be known at all and just be called Asian or Oriental, you know, something like that, right? And that there isn't even an effort to differentiate. So the way that manifests oftentimes is because the Chinese and Japanese have a much longer history in the United States, and especially in California, and because up until very recently, Chinese and Japanese culture were much more mainstream, right? I mean, Chinese food is essentially American food. Every American eats Chinese food, and a lot of Americans have like adapted Chinese food in their own ways. So they would often just kind of be mistaken for Chinese or Japanese, and that, you know, people weren't really concerned, right, about really knowing who Koreans are or what the differences are between Korean, Chinese, Japanese. And so I think, you know, on the one hand, you know, for people who want to be mistaken for Japanese, maybe they actually like that. But for people who are very anti-Japanese or anti-Chinese, it's quite a negative reaction that might manifest among those Korean people. And so, but obviously it contributes to this continued sense of lack of political recognition and therefore lack of social and cultural citizenship in the United States. And by that, I mean that there's this lack of mainstream membership, that you're not only the kind of more invisible racial group, but you're the more invisible ethnicity within that racial group. Obviously, more recently, things have changed. You know, it almost seems like overnight, Korean food has become really popular, especially on the West Coast, and I would say in New York and kind of these cosmopolitan global cities. I think Roy Choi is someone who made Korean food famous because he really kind of revamped the food truck movement. And what he did was he had a food truck called Gogi, and basically he mixed Mexican food with Korean food. And so he had these Mexican tacos with Korean kimchi in it and things like that. And it became a huge hit. Lines snaking around like city corners and streets to wait for these like kimchi tacos, you know? And so I think he was kind of the person who really started the trendiness and the popularity of Korean food. And then of course, Hallyu, right? K-pop and Gangnam Style and all that, like, you know, that has really marked a historic moment in the United States and the globe, really, in terms of awareness of Korean culture, awareness of Korean food. So, you know, things have changed. And my book was written before the rise of Psy and Gangnam Style and Korean food. But I would still, as I've mentioned before, be surprised if Koreans in Korea or Korean immigrants in the United States believed that because of those things, Korea had a stature equal to, for example, the popularity of, like I said earlier, like Michael Jordan or Martin Luther King or whomever. I think they would be surprised if it got to that level. I think they would say, you know, when Korean is a language that everybody wants to learn, you know, more so than Mandarin or more so than Spanish, I think something like that, I think, would make people feel like we have arrived. But until that moment, I still think Koreans are conscious of the fact that, you know, Korea is often not known about as much. Could people find Korea on a map, for example? I think those are the things that, in terms of political recognition, in terms of global citizenship, Koreans are quite aware of.
Expanding on that, is it a fair assessment to say that we should not just think of a color line, but also a citizenship line when we talk about the position of Koreans in the United States?
Yes, definitely. And that's one of my main arguments in the book. And here I draw on political scientist Claire Jean Kim. She is someone who pioneered a racial framework in which we're not just basing racial hierarchies and histories and racial ideologies, I should say, on the white over black color line, which really is premised on color. And, you know, through the color line, we understand a class hierarchy to exist there as well, right? That white America tends to be richer or more educated, you know, occupy more prestigious occupations, for example, than black America. That we also need to have, you know, in addition to that vertical axis of the color, or we could say color plus class line, as I argue in my book, we also need to have that horizontal axis of what I like to call a citizenship line, right? So whether or not you're actually seen as a full and equal member of that country, socially and culturally. So if, as Claire Jean Kim, the political scientist, models it, if you look at Asian Americans, for example, in the United States, and you can even kind of think about this in terms of the racialized, gendered global economic hierarchy, that Koreans, right, Korean Americans would be seen as in the middle, right, between white and blacks on that color plus class line, on that vertical axis. But if you draw a citizenship axis, and so the point next to the vertical line would be outsider or foreigner or un-American or not American, using the US case, right? And the end of that axis would be insider, American, right? Equal member of society. That Korean Americans would be actually positioned on the foreigner, outsider, not American side. So they occupy, and this is what I argue is transnationally related in terms of race to Korea, is that Koreans came to understand themselves after economic development as in the middle, right, between the rich white West and the poor black countries of the world, right? But also recognize that if you look at, you don't necessarily have to say insider in terms of the citizenship axis, maybe instead of saying insider, you would say, in global terms, you would say major or high political recognition and cultural recognition versus low political and cultural recognition. Well, globally, Korea would be at the position of low recognition, right? Or lower recognition. So what I argue is that those two different racial formations, one in Korea, one in the United States, are actually transnationally linked and they're related. And that's why they're so powerful, because they're quite similar. And so when Koreans in the United States are thinking about themselves, they're not just drawing on, okay, well, what happened once we, you know, hit the tarmac at LAX, right? What happens when once we got into JFK or LaGuardia in New York? Well, there was a lot of this understanding before they even came, you know, given that they existed within a global hierarchy, and given that there was U.S. Power and U.S. influence in Korea prior to coming. So I think that that transnational racialization is something that we really need to understand, rather than always being bounded by, you know, national borders and the idea that nothing spills over borders, or that we don't really live in a globalized world. I mean, you know, I think most people would not agree with that statement.
How did this foreignness, this lack of citizenship, affected their daily life?
Well, I think it contributes to Korean immigrants in the United States thinking that they really do not have much power, and that there is often this sense of, I guess I would say the sense of being invisible. And when you're invisible, you feel unimportant. So one of the things that I argue in the book is that For example, it's well established in Asian American studies as a discipline and in other disciplines that one of the racial characterizations of Asian people in the United States is as being foreign. And by foreign, you know, we're referring to the fact that if there's a war with Korea, for example, say the US and Korea go to war, or say, you know, Korea does something very anti-American in terms of its policy, right, that really angers the American public. Well, Korean Americans who've lived in the United States for centuries, say dating back to Hawaii, could actually be lumped in with Koreans in Korea, because the idea is that those Koreans in the United States are actually not American. They're not quintessentially American, but that they're from another country. So one of the things that happens, and it has happened to me, people will tell you, go back to your country. But I will tell them, but this is our country, and we don't really know any other country. I was born in the United States, you know? So there's this idea of foreignness that lumps Koreans in the United States, even though they're Americans and have been Americans longer than some Southern Eastern European groups, who are now the majority, that those Korean Americans are still somehow actually an extension of Korea, the country, or Japan, or China, or Vietnam, or whatever Asian country we're talking about, right? We can see it historically in the World War II mass incarceration of around 120,000 Japanese Americans. I mean, these were Japanese Americans. These were people who held U.S. citizenship, right? Who demonstrated no anti-U.S. activity, who were assimilated along many lines. Yet when Pearl Harbor was struck by Japanese bombs, Japanese Americans as a group were rounded up and mass incarcerated in concentration camps. So that is an example of being racialized as foreign, right? Despite being American in every possible way. And by the way, there was never any anti-US activity found among a single Japanese American person in the US. So you can see how powerful the idea of racializing a group as foreign, as outsiders, as not American has, right? It can completely take away your civil liberties. So that foreign racialization is really powerful. And that's something that Koreans are very, very aware of. So there's that dimension of being seen as explicitly other, explicitly linked to another country. But there's also what I'm talking about, the idea of invisibility, that foreignness is not just about being explicitly different, but I think it's also about being seen as so marginal or so holding so little power that they're a group that we can kind of define ourselves and kind of or ignore at will. And Koreans are very cognizant of that. So I started out this interview talking about the 1992 Los Angeles unrest, and I think that's a really watershed moment in Korean American history. It was like a baptism by fire into American race dynamics, because it was an example of how Koreans could be seen as explicitly foreign and explicitly other, right? These immigrants that come in, they don't speak English, they're, you know, basically screaming and crying this nonsensical language in these media cameras. They have their own kind of brusque or insular, clannish ways, right? But then they're also invisible in the sense that they're being defined by the American media rather than Koreans being able to define themselves. They're invisible in the sense that they can be used by politicians in the media as a scapegoat in some sense in this 1992 unrest, because as I reminded you, the conflict was originally between whites and blacks, white police officers and a black American motorist. And that history has a long, long legacy, right? But then all of a sudden, the media decided to focus on, oh no, you know, the riots in LA are really because blacks and Koreans hate each other. And blacks hate Koreans. So therefore, they're, you know, burning their stores down and, you know, they're destroying Koreatown, right? So they were being used and being kind of appropriated in a way that really cast into relief how invisible and how, I guess, not powerful Koreans were in defining themselves. And so I think that's an example of how Koreans not only came to understand themselves, but also through that 1992 baptism by fire, they really realized that they had to become more politically involved. They had to really make the U.S. aware of who Korean Americans are, who Korean immigrants are, but also about Korea. And so after that, there were changes, right? Obviously, we haven't arrived yet, but those changes did result because of that historic moment in 1992.
In addition, or maybe even in contrast to this invisible minority, Koreans have also been described as model minority. What does it mean, and what do the members of this minority think about that actual label?
Yes, the model minority ideology really began around the 1960s in the United States, and it had to do with the fact that a lot of Asians, including Koreans, were coming to the United States through family reunification, but also through professional visa clauses, right? So that these were college-educated, urban, middle-class or higher professionals that were selectively coming to the United States. And so, for example, from Korea, the migration has mostly been middle-class or higher. And so it's a very select group that's actually leaving the peninsula and going to the United States. So you see these Asian immigrants being able to successfully, you know, work in white-collar occupations, or many of them are graduate students studying at, you know, top universities in the U.S., or you see them doing small business, right, serving as small business proprietors and being able to make a strong living that way. And because of that, and also the fact that many Koreans immigrated to the United States because they believed that the Korean education system was much too competitive and too expensive and too harrowing a journey for their children to have to go through, that they immigrated to the U.S. And so the children, knowing that my entire family came to the U.S. for my education, would often be conscientious, right? Study hard and do well in school. That was their responsibility, their role in the family. So you see, you know, educational, academic success, you see occupational success. So starting in the 1960s, there was this idea that Asians like Korean immigrants were this model minority. And the importance of the word model is that it was also a political discourse that allowed the powers that be to denigrate Black Americans and Latinos and Native Americans and other groups, for example, who were not doing so well. And of course, you know, most of us know that that's because of the history of institutionalized racism in the United States and anti-immigrant sentiment in the United States. But for those who are just sort of looking at the end of the process and seeing impoverished Black Americans in inner cities or impoverished Latinos in inner cities compared to these, you know, wealthier Asian immigrants that are living in the suburbs or what have you, then it's easy to say, well, the Asians are the model minority and those minorities are the unmodel minority, right? They're the minorities that, you know, complain, because these Asian immigrants prove that if you just work hard and follow the Protestant ethic, that you pull yourself up by your bootstraps, that anyone can become middle class or live the American dream in the United States. So really, these claims by these 1960s, you know, social movements, civil rights movement, the Brown Beret movement, the Chicano movement, the Red Power movement, right? All these claims are really just dismissible, because their lack of education or their impoverished state has nothing to do with American institutionalized racism or classism or, you know, any kind of, I guess, macro level hierarchy like that. It just has to do with their lack of will. So that's how the model minority mythology came about. And it's interesting, if you interview Korean immigrants and even the second generation who are not, you know, those who study Asian American studies or sociology, for instance, they haven't even necessarily heard of the term itself, model minority, which initially surprised me. But that's because, like, I was operating from academia, and it's widespread in academia. But in terms of everyday knowledge, the term is not that actually well known. But if you tell them the meaning of it, right, that the idea is that Asian immigrants have this intrinsic intelligence that explains their success, but it's this kind of intrinsic cultural kind of nature that can be traced to, you know, I guess their home countries of Korea, Japan, for example, mixed with their incredible work ethic, right? Their diligence, their willingness to study, their willingness to work hard, that these Asian immigrants are, you know, basically the ones that, you know, other minorities should follow. And if they do, then they will reach and realize that same level of success as the Asian immigrants. If you explain that, you know, meaning, that racialized meaning to, you know, these Korean immigrants in the second generation, they're like, oh, yeah, I'm familiar with that. And many of them will say, I actually believe that there's some truth to that, right? They don't, I mean, some of them will buy into the stereotype, and this is a really like biologized notion that, you know, Asians are somehow smarter, especially at math, right? And science and things like that. Some of them buy into that, right? Without really seeing it as a result of the really high education systems their parents came from and the emphasis on math in their parents' countries, but also how hard people study here. But they really focus on the work ethic, you know, how hard the Korean immigrants work and their children work because they're immigrants, right? Because they came, for example, for the children's education, so the children study exceptionally hard. You know, that they buy into that. They often believe in that. I mean, you know, stereotypes have some kernel of truth in them, right? That there are Asian Americans who do very, very well. There's quite a few Asian Americans who do very, very well. And so there is that reason behind why you see, you know, Korean immigrants or Korean Americans buying into that notion. But at the same time, just as much as Korean immigrants or Korean immigrants praise their own group, they also complain about their group, right? So linking the model minority to the foreigner ideology we just talked about, you know, there's a lot of complaints about how, but Koreans just do the same thing, you know? They don't go out and become star athletes, or they don't go out and become actors and actresses and singers, you become lawyers and doctors, and, you know, or they just stay in Koreatown and they just speak Korean, or they just, you know, only consort with other Koreans, right? There's, you know, so there's also this discourse like that. I don't want to give the impression that, oh, you know, we praise ourselves in this way and that's the only racialized meaning that we focus on. The quick point I also make about the model minority is that given ethno-nationalism in Korea and this idea of we're this really smart 부지런한 사람, right, just this, these diligent people, you can see how the model minority ideology in the U.S. would make sense, right? The only other thing I want to say about the model minority is that in many ways it can also be a label that can harm Korean immigrants and Korean Americans, because this is where the two-pronged racialization of foreigner and model minority meet, which is the idea that because Asian American groups have done so well, for example, academically, right, that then white Americans have become really fearful of Koreans outdoing them and besting them in academic realms, right? So there's also the way in which being a model minority, or the fear and the threat of the model minority, also draws out white Americans' competition against them as foreigners who don't belong, who don't deserve to beat us at our own game, right? So in many ways, if white Americans didn't see Asians as other, if they just saw them as like whitening people or people who are white like us, there wouldn't be this distinction between why are they, right, this kind of competitive threat, you know, overtaking us academically and possibly in the professional occupations, right? But because they actually do foreignize them and other them as this separate racial group, that threat of competition gives rise to more kind of anti-foreigner, anti, you know, Asian ideologies.
Returning to South Korea, to what extent do the experiences of South Koreans immigrants to the U.S. impact the life and worldviews of those who stayed in South Korea?
Yes, just like I talked about with respect to the pre-U.S. socialization that immigrants receive in Korea, I think there's this kind of sense that race is not explicit. It's something that's understood, or it's kind of in the background, or it's incidental, but that explicitly what Korean immigrants will say that they share with Koreans in Korea is not necessarily about race, right? I mean, you know, remember in Korea, you know, even the word race is not necessarily translated the same way as in the US. That's right. It's the idea of nation, right? And bloodline. But I think another really important message that Korean immigrants send without necessarily realizing it and maybe thinking about it as more like a practical anecdote is talking about the discrimination that they've also experienced from white Americans. And that could be just in the everyday realm, like because I can't speak English that well, they seem to dislike me or avoid me or kind of look down on me. Those stories, or talking about it in terms of the 1992 unrest. So that's seen as more structural, right? More macro. But one of the major stories that Korean immigrants share with Koreans here is that, look, one of the reasons the riots broke out, or the main reason it broke out, was not necessarily because blacks don't like us, right? It also has to do with the fact that white America could have helped save Koreatown. The police could have come out. There could have been intervention. But Korean immigrants kept calling the police and kept asking for help from politicians during this 5 days of, you know, complete chaos and burning and looting. And the police didn't really come, you know, and if they came, they would just stand by and watch and mostly just kind of ensure that order was happening while, I mean, that sounds kind of ironic but and paradoxical, but that there was no murder, that there was, you know, no, I guess, like major vandalism, but, you know, they would just kind of try to control the chaos, I guess, right? And Korean immigrants learned very quickly that when predominantly white Beverly Hills and predominantly white Westwood, which is where UCLA is located, when the rioters or the protesters, as I'd rather say, were starting to move into those areas, that's when not only the LAPD and other police were called in to prevent that from happening, but the National Guard, which is national level, their federal level military, came in and intervened. So Korean immigrants really understood this to be a racial slap in the face. That when it was just Koreatown, it didn't matter. Again, the foreign and invisible minority. And then after that, what was so crucial is that because Koreatown and Koreans sustained the largest amount of damage, which was about $1 billion in property damage, they asked for compensation from the government, right? We're taxpaying citizens. You guys didn't help. We want compensation. To this day, there's been no compensation. So one of the messages that Korean immigrants send to Koreans is, look, I just want you to know that if you think you're going to come here and never experience discrimination or never experience hardship, or you're just going to live the American dream and it's going to be easy street, I think that you should stay in Korea. You know, that's one of the pieces of advice that they often give. If you just want to come here and only consort with other Koreans and never learn English and never assimilate into mainstream America, which by that they probably mean mostly white America. If that's what you're going to do, then I would advise you just to stay in Korea, because that's not really what living in America or the United States is all about. So these are the kinds of messages they're sending that, you know, are often couched in terms of practicality, but really has a lot to do with race, right? And of course, because of globalized media, the 1992 unrest, you know, the fact that Koreans get a lot of the media that Americans get, right? There's definitely an understanding through the news and things like that about, you know, what's going on racially, culturally in the United States. So, you know, I think that's a really important message and worldview that gets transmitted. If briefly I look the other way, what South Koreans, you know, are saying to Korean immigrants, I think what Korean immigrants also realize is that Korea itself has changed so much and is changing constantly, right? That's one of the things I say about Seoul and Korea, and is that it's hard to study because it's always changing. But, you know, the messages that they send, I think, are really taken sort of in a fashion that is really profound for Korean immigrants, because immigrants, no matter where they go, no matter what country they hail from, they're often kind of stuck in the time of the country when they left, but don't really know all that's changed and all that's happened in the home country since. And so hearing and learning about Tamunhwa and all of that, I think that's really big. And so I think as that continues to progress, I think there'll be a lot more explicit conversations about what it means to live in a racially, cultural diverse country, you know, what it means, you know, to have immigrant towns and things like that. I think those kinds of conversations will become more explicit.
Professor Kim, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much. It was my honor.
This was Korea and the World. To make sure you don't miss our next episode, bookmark our website, koreaandtheworld.org, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, and follow us on Facebook and Twitter.